Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents 50 Pentecostal and Charismatic Leaders Every Christian Should Know by Dean Merrill, narrated by Jim Denison. Foreword. It is my great privilege to write the foreword for this timely book. Dean Merrill has a special gift for combining valuable content with an engaging style, making learning both enjoyable and edifying. And edifying this book is, reminding us of the difference that empowerment by God's Spirit can make in our lives. One mark of an ingeniously designed work is that it meets a need that its predecessors had not yet recognized. There are an increasing number of works on Pentecostal and Charismatic history and some biographical treatments of key figures. But where does one start? This book offers a handy primer on most of the leading figures, a valuable refresher for those schooled in Pentecostalism, and a crucial survey to initiate beginners. Pentecostals and Charismatics will relish the book for treating some of their favorite figures and for filling gaps in knowledge about the histories of their movements, and outsiders will find this book valuable to expose them to the basics of the history and figures in a movement that is now exploding across the world. Depending on how one defines Pentecostals and Charismatics, estimates of their global presence now often exceed 500 million, making them the second largest Christian movement in the world after Roman Catholicism, which itself includes a substantial number of Charismatics. Understanding the development of Pentecostal and Charismatic history, therefore, is valuable for every listener. And encountering stories about the lives of key figures is one of the most interesting ways to engage that history. Tracing these stories makes for exciting listening, especially at the hands of a nimble writer such as Dean Merrill. Even in our age of tweets and sound bites, and even for ADHD persons such as myself, this collection of 50 fast-moving, brief vignettes holds our attention. With our respective interests and traditions, various listeners might have added some different figures and left others out. Some would have included Charles Parham. I would have voted for Pandita Ramabai. And, here my New Testament scholar bias is showing, Gordon Fee, while omitting a few figures, the naming of whom would further reveal my biases. In many cases, however, the figures we would have left out are those about whom we have the most to learn, and we already know enough about the figures we would have added. For the most part, the author's selections are ideal in providing a fairly representative cross-sample of Western Charismatics and Pentecostals, especially from the past 80 years. At this distance from the beginning of the Pentecostal revival, it is easier to identify the most influential figures than it might have been in the immediate wake of the initial revival. William Seymour's stature has rightly grown, for example, along with renewed appreciation of his impact. Because history requires some hindsight, it is more difficult to choose the most influential figures of the past half century. The charismatic movement, moreover, is diffuse, spread throughout so many denominations and sub-movements that few of us are familiar with all its reaches. This makes a primer on many of these figures all the more valuable. Recent figures are naturally also more controversial, but love them or hate them, hopefully in a Christian way, they are figures and voices we should know. Those concerned about any of the choices or wondering why their pastor is left out should remember that these are inevitably samples. Yet Merrill has done a superb job in providing an array that reflects the great diversity of Pentecostals and Charismatics, both genders, multiple ethnicities, and representatives from a wide range of denominations. Because many of the selected figures were associated with other Pentecostal or Charismatic leaders, moreover, Merrill manages to sneak in a few more figures than the 50 specifically named. For example, Kerry Judd Montgomery and Elias Letwaba, without adding extra space. Much more remains to be said about significant figures in the history of Pentecostals and Charismatics in Africa, Asia, and Latin America than was possible in this book's limit of 50. Historians will also say more about the figures included. The genius of this book, however, is what makes it invaluable for its purpose, as a handy, succinct, and inexpensive gold mine of knowledge. The stories in this book remind us that God uses all kinds of people, including people like us. All had flaws. As Merrill's balanced presentation of these figures point out, none was perfect. But God is eager to use those who recognize their need to depend on Him. This book reminds us of a God who calls to us all, ready to use any vessel wholly devoted to His service. Dr. Craig S. Keener, FM, and Ada Thompson, Professor of Biblical Studies, Asbury Theological Seminary. Introduction. Great Cloud of Witnesses. Some of the names in the table of contents you will quickly recognize, while others may be quite unfamiliar to you. But all of them, listed chronologically by order of birth, have stories to tell and insights to share out of the Pentecostal and Charismatic movements of the past 120 years. In the words of esteemed Emory University professor Fred Craddock, anyone who can't remember further back than his or her own birth is an orphan. Choosing the 50 was a challenge, to be sure, which involved long discussions with the publisher. You may see a name that causes you to say, "Why would you include him?" On the other hand, you may be asking, "How could you leave out blank?" We had, in fact, a sizable bench of additional names we would like to have included, but there were only 50 slots. I confess that in the end, our choices were personal as we sought to hold true to the title criterion of people every Christian should know. Let it be noted that none of the 50 was perfect. Each of them harbored human flaws and misassumptions. I have not tried to gloss over these, but to report them charitably. Most of the subjects have, over the course of their ministries, been on the receiving end of public criticisms, some justified, others unfair. From each case we can learn. I must give grateful thanks to the following historians, without whose work I could never have developed this book. Frank Bartleman, eyewitness to the Azusa Street Awakening, Dr. Vincent Sinan, Dr. Mel Robick, Stanley Frotcham, Dr. Edith Blumhofer, Dr. Stanley Burgess, and Dr. Amos Young. Thank God that these could not only speak in tongues, but also write in lucid English. Having said that, I invite you to give a hearing to this great cloud of witnesses, men and women who, if I may paraphrase the language of Hebrews chapter 11, by the Spirit preached New Testament truth, healed the sick, cast out dark forces, withstood the arrows of accusation, held true to their calling, and even shed light in faraway places of whom the world was not worthy. Their reward awaits. 1. Mariah Woodsworth Eder, 1844-1924, the female forerunner. She was only 11 years old that summer day when her father collapsed in a field on their Ohio farm with a fatal sunstroke. Mariah, pronounced Mariah, Underwood and her older siblings would now need to drop out of school and go to work, helping their grieving mother keep food on the table. And things had been going so well the past year, since her hard-drinking father and his wife had begun attending a nearby Disciples of Christ congregation. There, young Mariah had heard the gospel for the first time. She was born again at age 13, baptized in a creek, and soon thereafter felt she heard the voice of God saying, "Go to the highways and hedges and gather the lost sheep." That made no sense to her, in that the disciples did not accept women in the pulpit. She knew of no other females doing this kind of thing. Even Catherine Booth, eventual mother of the Salvation Army, did not preach her first sermon across the ocean until 1860. Women in America could not even vote, for that matter. The only way forward, she assumed, would be to marry a Christian man along whose side she could work. In her late teens, she married Philo Horace Woodsworth, a nearby farmer. Six children came along rapidly, and with them, one heartache upon another, as five succumbed by the age of seven. She later wrote about their dying moments in agonizing detail. Only the oldest, a daughter, lived to adulthood. It was not until she reached the age of 35 that she dared to speak publicly in a meeting of the Society of Friends, Quakers, which had always welcomed women in ministry. When she got up to speak, she was given a vision of the pit of hell, with unwary people falling into it. She cried out for her audience to be saved from such horror. The response was immediate. Soon thereafter, she received another riveting vision in the night. Her description: "The dear Savior stood by me and asked what I was doing on earth. I felt condemned and said, 'Lord, I am going to work in thy vineyard.' The Lord said, 'When?' And I answered, 'When I get prepared for the work.' Then the Lord said to me, 'Don't you know that while you are getting ready, souls are perishing? Go now, and I will be with you.' I told him that I could not talk to the people. I did not know what to say, and they would not listen to me. Jesus said, 'You can tell the people what the Lord has done for your soul. Tell of the glory of God and the love of Jesus. Tell sinners to repent and prepare for death and the judgment, and I will be with you.' Still, I made one excuse after another, and Jesus would answer, 'Go, and I will be with you.' From that point forward in the 1880s, she began to hold public meetings in her area. People swarmed to hear her and to respond to her salvation call. Regarding one 1883 meeting in Fairview, Ohio, she wrote, "I felt impressed that God was going to restore love and harmony in the church. Those present came to the altar, made a full consecration, and prayed for a baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire. That night it came. 15 came to the altar screaming for mercy. Men and women fell and lay like dead. I felt it was the work of God, but did not know how to explain it or what to say. I was a little frightened. The ministers and old saints wept and praised the Lord. They said it was the Pentecost power, that the Lord was visiting them in great mercy and power." Soon she felt God calling her to also pray for the sick. At first, she resisted this, fearing it would distract from evangelism. The Lord assured her that if she prayed for the sick, more people would come and be saved. She obeyed. As the meetings became more dramatic, her husband became more skeptical, wishing Mariah would remain a quiet farmer's wife. He gradually grew hostile and began drinking heavily, as well as seducing some of the women who came to his wife's meetings. There was also evidence of some mental imbalance, perhaps a reaction to the deaths of his 5 children. By the late 1880s, Philo and Mariah had separated, and they were divorced in 1891. He quickly remarried, but died of typhoid fever within a year of the divorce. Mariah conducted his funeral. Meanwhile, her travels gradually took her across America, from Chicago to Atlanta to San Francisco to Kansas City. Accounts of healing cures began to pile up: chorea, involuntary jerking of the shoulders, hips, and face; spinal meningitis; cancer; deafness; misshapen limbs and shoulders that had never healed correctly following an accident. In 1889, she purchased a tent that could seat 8,000, setting it up for the first time in Oakland, California. "The power of God was all over the congregation and around the city," she remembered. "The Holy Ghost would fall on the people while we were preaching. The multitude would be held still, like as though death was in their midst. Many of the most intelligent and best-dressed men would fall back in their seats, with their hands held up to God, being held up under the mighty power of God. Men and women fell all over the tent, like trees in a storm. Some would have visions of God." More than once, her tent became too small for the crowds. Her largest audience was apparently a camp meeting 5 miles outside Alexandria, Indiana, with an estimated crowd of 25,000 people. The people had to listen carefully, since no sound amplification was yet on hand in those days. "From a high platform in a grove, I talked nearly 2 hours. The people all stood. The solemnity of death rested upon the multitude. Some had their bodies healed, and thousands were brought to Christ." In view of the manifestations, some newspapers began to dub her the trance evangelist. She compared the falling with what happened to the Apostle Peter in Acts chapter 10, when God had to immobilize him before he would agree to take the gospel to Cornelius and his household. In Framingham, Massachusetts, she was arrested for practicing medicine without a license, but she was released when too many citizens came forward with credible accounts of their healings. The same thing happened in Fremont, Nebraska, outside Omaha. Her only defense, the power of God which was given to the apostles in their day, has never been taken from the church. Let the Holy Ghost work in any way that agrees with the Word of God. In St. Louis in 1890, local psychiatrists filed charges of insanity against her for claiming that she saw visions of God. One night, a gang surrounded her tent. The once timid farm girl wrote, "They had pistols and clubs and were ready to kill us and tear down the tent. It looked as if we would all be killed. Several ministers tried to talk, but were stoned down or their voice drowned out. It looked like surrender or death. It was an awful sight to see a little band of Christians sitting nearly frozen to their seats with fear, surrounded by a mob of wild, fierce men and women, many of them half drunk, their eyes and faces red and inflamed. I said to my co-workers, 'We will never give up, and if they take us out of the tent before we are ready to go, they will take us out dead.' I told them to lead in prayer one after the other, and the God of Elijah would answer. A feeling of the awful presence of God began to fall on the people. Then I arose and raised my hands in the name of the Lord and commanded them to listen. I said the Lord had sent me there to do them good, and that I would not leave until the Lord told me to, when our work was done. I told them the Lord would strike dead the first one that tried to harm us or to strike us with a dagger. The power of God fell, and the fear of God came upon all the multitude. The sweat came on their faces, and they stood like as though in a trance. The men began to take their pipes out of their mouths and their hats off. They felt they stood naked and guilty before God. Tears ran down many faces through the dirt, leaving streaks. They all passed out quietly. After that, the hoodlum element always respected me." Her meetings in Los Angeles during the winter of 1893-94 ran on for 5 weeks. Along the way of her travels, in 1902, she married a man she met in Arkansas, Samuel Eder, who supported her ministry. She added his last name to her own, forming a hyphenated surname, an unusual move in those times. She watched the 1906 awakening at the Azusa Street Mission from a distance, not sure at first whether its teaching was valid. But soon she came to embrace the Pentecostal message demonstrated there, first speaking in tongues herself in 1912 at the age of 68. That same year saw another nearly 5-month run of meetings in Dallas, where she preached 3 meetings a day. She spoke at the 1913 Worldwide Camp Meeting near Pasadena, California, where, according to one published report, many were healed as Sister Eder raised her hands toward heaven while she was leaving the tent. Samuel Eder died the following year. Mariah was present in Hot Springs, Arkansas, for the 1914 organizing of the Assemblies of God, although she noticed that some of the men in charge were careful not to give her too much authority. Nevertheless, Assemblies historian Carl Brumback later honored her by writing, "She looked just like your grandmother, but exercised tremendous spiritual authority over sin, disease, and demons." Her books sold widely and were abridged for editions in French, Italian, Danish, Swedish, Egyptian, and Hindi, among others. As her strength weakened in her final years, she sometimes had to be carried to the meetings, where she would stand to preach, and then be carried home again. She retired to open a tabernacle in Indianapolis, today called Lakeview Church, but kept preaching right up until her death on September 16, 1924, a praise of tongues upon her lips. She is buried there next to her daughter and son-in-law. She was, in a sense, a John the Baptist-type forerunner of the coming Pentecostal and Charismatic awakenings, bold, unconventional, and controversial at times, but undeniably anointed by God to bring salvation, healing, and divine power to the world. 2. Smith Wigglesworth, 1859-1947, bold as a lion. 15-year-old Kenneth Ware was hurrying down the street one day when suddenly a man's voice rang out, "Come here, boy, put out your tongue." He had never seen the man before, and he hadn't even introduced himself. But Kenneth did not have the nerve to run off. He did what the man ordered. The teenager said not a word because he knew if he tried, he would only stutter. His speech impediment had been a serious drawback for as long as he could remember. Before he knew what was happening, the audacious man reached out and grabbed his tongue. "Lad, this tongue will preach the gospel," he announced, and then walked away. From that moment forward, young Kenneth never stuttered again. He preached his first sermon at the age of 17 and became a lifelong missionary, especially to Jewish refugees in France. The stranger who had stopped him on the street was none other than the bold British evangelist Smith Wigglesworth, whose spiritual gifts of the word of knowledge, healing, and miracles could be downright shocking at times. He, like the boy, had grown up with major limitations, not physically, but in terms of opportunity. He had been put to work in a mill by the age of 7. As a result, he received no formal schooling. He learned to read only in his mid-20s, when his wife taught him. He managed to support his family, he eventually had 5 children, by working as a plumber in the northern English town of Bradford. One thing was sure in his mind, however, that he belonged to Christ as the result of being saved at the age of 8 in a Methodist revival meeting. He had been confirmed by an Anglican bishop, baptized by immersion in a Baptist church, and instructed about the Bible by a Plymouth Brethren friend. In his late teens, young Smith was drawn to the Salvation Army, where he took up street evangelism. He also met a gifted young woman who could preach well, Polly Featherstone. They married in 1882. He stayed in her shadow for many years, until he began to hear about divine healing and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Hungry for a greater spiritual reality, he sought this baptism and finally received it when an Anglican vicar's wife, Mary Body, laid hands on him, prayed, and then left the room. But unexpectedly, he said later, the fire fell. The joy was so great that when I came to utter it, my tongue failed, and I began to worship God in other tongues as the Spirit gave me utterance. Back home, Polly was less than impressed with his exuberant report. "I have been preaching for 20 years," she said, "and you have sat beside me on the platform. But on Sunday, you will preach yourself, and I'll see what there is in it." Up to this point, any pulpit attempts by Smith had broken down within 2 or 3 minutes, requiring Polly to step up and rescue the service. The next Sunday was an entirely different story. Smith Wigglesworth held forth confidently from Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 through 3. "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings." Verse 1, KJV. Polly sat slack-jawed in the back of the mission, eventually sputtering aloud, "That's not my Smith, Lord. That's not my Smith." From that day forward, his ministry grew by leaps and bounds, eventually replacing the plumbing business. People were saved and healed in his meetings. Sometimes results emerged even at a long distance. Once a woman came to him worried about her son's marriage. The young man had served the Lord originally, but now the marriage was in such bad shape that he had moved back in with his mother. Wigglesworth was not intimidated in the least. "Give me your handkerchief," he said to the woman. He put it between his hands and said, "Lord, smite this young man with conviction." He then returned the handkerchief to the woman and told her to put it under her son's pillow, saying nothing. That night, the son did not return home until late. His mother was already in bed. He went to his room, got ready for bed, and crawled in. Immediately, he was seized with a terrible feeling. He soon got out of bed, fell on his knees, and repented before God. Then he got dressed again, awakened his mother, and said, "Don't worry, Mum. I'm going back home. I'll see you tomorrow." And in fact, the young couple had a wonderful reconciliation. Wigglesworth's booming voice left little room for debate. His grammar was never perfect, except curiously when he would interpret a message in tongues. A man once teased him after receiving one of his letters. "You know, you spelled the title of the Holy Spirit 7 different ways in your letter." The evangelist was not embarrassed. "Did you understand it?" he asked. "Oh, yes." "Then thank God," Wigglesworth said. "That's all that matters." He was in some ways like the early apostles, of whom the Bible says in Acts chapter 4, verse 13, "When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished and they took note that these men had been with Jesus." Polly Wigglesworth passed away in 1913. She was only 51. For the next 3 decades, her husband traveled more than ever to the European continent, to America, to Africa, and beyond. 2 books of his sermons, Ever Increasing Faith and Faith That Prevails, were widely welcomed. The theme song of his meetings was usually the simple chorus, "Only believe, only believe. All things are possible, only believe." He had no interest in what medical science might accomplish. He was absolutely fearless in confronting the work of Satan, which is what he considered disease to be. If someone had stomach trouble, for example, he was not beyond hitting the person's abdomen with his fist as he prayed. When questioned about this tactic, he said, "I don't hit people, I hit the devil. If they get in the way, I can't help it." And once the shock wore off, the sufferers often found they had, in fact, been made whole. When he went to Sweden for a campaign, the government forbade him to touch anyone for whom he prayed. Wigglesworth asked the Lord what to do. He felt led to ask instead for everyone with a physical need to stand, or at least to raise their hand, then lay hands on their own body area in need while he led a prayer for healing from the platform. The power of God swept through the huge audience, with hundreds receiving their miracle. Wigglesworth's son-in-law, James Salter, who often accompanied him in his travels, said, "We never knew what he was going to do next. We were always afraid he would go too far. But he never did. He always said, 'You can't go too far with God. In fact, you can't go far enough.'" One time he was staying with a Church of England curate who had suffered the amputation of both legs below the knee. In those days, few prosthetics were available to help such a person. After dinner, Wigglesworth suddenly blurted out to the man, "Go and get a new pair of shoes in the morning." What? Was this some kind of cruel joke? The minister hardly knew how to take this directive. But during the night, he sensed God saying to him, "Do as my servant hath said." The man could get no sleep the rest of the night. Early the next morning, he got into his wheelchair and was waiting downtown when the shoe store opened. He went in and sat down. When the clerk came, he said, "Would you get me a pair of shoes, please?" "Yes, sir. Size and color?" Then the clerk glanced down at the man's legs and said, "I'm sorry, sir. We can't help you." "It's all right, young man," the curate replied. "But I do want a pair of shoes. Size 8, color black." The clerk could not think what else to do but to get the requested shoes. When he returned with the box, the curate proceeded to put one stump into a shoe, and immediately a foot and leg formed. He moved on to the other stump, and the same thing happened again. He walked out of the shop with not only a new pair of shoes, but also a new pair of legs. When the man got back home, Wigglesworth was not surprised. He had fully expected this to happen. "As far as God is concerned," he claimed, "there is no difference between forming a limb and healing a broken bone." Those who knew Wigglesworth closely said that over the course of his active ministry, 14 different people were raised from the dead. Late in his life, he was ministering in South Africa when a significant prophecy came. One morning, about 7 o'clock, he came barging into the office of his local host, David Duplessis, head of the Apostolic Faith Mission. Laying his hands on the man's shoulders and, in fact, pushing him against the wall, he began to speak on God's behalf. "You have been in Jerusalem long enough. I will send you to the uttermost parts of the earth. You will bring the message of Pentecost to all churches. You will travel more than evangelists do. God is going to revive the churches in the last days and through them turn the world upside down. Even the Pentecostal movement will become a mere joke compared with the revival which God will bring through the churches." To hear the remarkable fulfillment of this prophecy given in 1936, refer to this book's Profiles of David Duplessis, Chapter 13, and other Episcopalians, Lutherans, and Catholics throughout. 3. Charles H. Mason, 1866 to 1961, The Man Who Said, "Yes, Lord." A few heads might have turned at the Azusa Street Mission when, in March 1907, Charles H. Mason and two associates showed up. Anyone who would have gotten to know them would have learned they had ridden the train nearly 2,000 miles from Memphis, Tennessee, to come see and experience the Spirit's activity. A few more questions would have revealed that Mason, at the age of 42, was an ordained minister and, in fact, co-founder of a collection of black holiness or sanctified churches across the Mid-South called the Church of God in Christ, COGIC. He had come up with that name one day while walking along a street in Little Rock, basing it upon the language of 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 14, and 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 1. The group was already legally registered and ordaining clergy. Mason himself had been ordained by the Missionary Baptists and had graduated from the Minister's Institute at Arkansas Baptist College. His ongoing spiritual quest led him, however, to seek sanctification as a distinct work of grace, which did not go over well with the Baptist Convention. By the late 1890s, he and a colleague were busy preaching the holiness message in churches and camp meetings, calling listeners to a deeper walk with God. Then came news of a revival in Los Angeles. Mason simply had to go see for himself. The first day in the meeting, I sat to myself, away from those that went with me. I began to thank God in my heart for all things, for when I heard some speak in tongues, I knew it was right. Though I did not understand it, nevertheless, it was sweet to me. I also thank God for Elder William J. Seymour, who came and preached a wonderful sermon. His words were sweet and powerful. When he closed his sermon, he said, "All of those that want to be sanctified or baptized with the Holy Ghost, go to the upper room, and all those who want to be justified, come to the altar." I said, "That is the place for me. Glory." While Mason was pleased to see the multiracial gathering of believers, all seeking God's abundance, he wasn't entirely comfortable when white brothers sought to pray with him for the Spirit's outpouring. After all, he had lost his sharecropper father as a 12-year-old boy when a yellow fever epidemic swept through and nearby hospitals would not treat blacks. A year later, he himself had been stricken with apparent tuberculosis. Only the desperate prayers of his mother and her friends pulled him back to health. Did these whites at Azusa Street truly have his best interests at heart? That night, he later recounted, "The Lord spoke to me that Jesus saw all of this world's wrongs, but did not attempt to set them right until God overshadowed him with the Holy Ghost. And I said I was no better than my Lord, and if I wanted him to baptize me, I would have to let rights and wrongs alone and look to Him. So I said yes to God." Back at the mission, "The Spirit came upon the saints and upon me. Then I gave up for the Lord to have His way within me. So there came a wave of glory into me, and all of my being was filled with the glory of the Lord. So when He had gotten me straight on my feet, there came a light which enveloped my whole being above the brightness of the sun. When I opened my mouth to say glory, a flame touched my tongue which ran down me. My language changed, and no word could I speak in my own tongue. Oh, I was filled with the glory of the Lord. My soul was then satisfied. Charles Mason, the only denominational head to actually visit the mission, stayed in the Azusa Street atmosphere for more than a month before returning to Memphis. There he immediately began to share what the Spirit had done in his life. His friend and COGIC co-founder, Charles Price Jones, was not convinced, however, and after days and nights of intense debate, the two separated. By the fall of 1907, Mason was able to reconstitute COGIC as a clearly Pentecostal body, serving as general overseer and starting a new periodical, The Whole Truth. The next half-dozen years were exciting times of growth as ministers of both races sought ordination at Mason's hand. There were as many white COGIC churches in that period as black ones. Unfortunately, the prevailing segregation of American culture began to seep into Christian circles until a call for a general council in April 1914 to form a new association, the Assemblies of God, was sent to whites only. Mason did attend that council in Hot Springs, Arkansas, and was even asked to speak on Thursday night to the 400 white preachers who had gathered, many of whom held COGIC credentials. But a formal embrace of COGIC was not to be done. The interracial fabric of Azusa Street was unraveling. Mason was not sidetracked by this. He continued to preach and build up the churches under his care. He commissioned traveling evangelists, established an annual International Holy Convocation, which draws large attendance to this day, and set up departments for women's ministry, Sunday school, and young people. When he preached, he would often migrate seamlessly from speaking to singing to praying. His signature song was, "Yes, yes, 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 Lord." He became known for leading 3 to 4 hour prayer meetings as well as all-night prayer vigils, called shut-ins. When America entered World War I in 1917, Mason, like many other early Pentecostals, took a pacifist stand. He could not abide the drafting of young African-American men to advance freedom in Europe while enduring racism and discrimination at home. He called it a rich man's war and a poor man's fight, and urged his associates to seek conscientious objector status instead. For this, the FBI opened an investigation of him and even arrested him in Lexington, Mississippi, for allegedly preaching against the war. A white lawyer and former Nazarene preacher traveled to Lexington and posted a $2,000 cash bond to get Mason released. His leadership as presiding bishop continued undeterred, and COGIC continued to grow. His style was soft-spoken but firm, according to one historian. By 1945, a huge church complex was dedicated in Memphis, including a 3,700-seat auditorium known today as Mason Temple, where he is buried. Many people do not realize that it was from this pulpit that Martin Luther King Jr. delivered his iconic sermon, "I've Been to the Mountaintop," on April 3, 1968, only to be assassinated the next afternoon. COGIC, meanwhile, has become one of the top 5 church bodies in America, with more than 6.5 million U.S. communicants, plus 1 to 3 million more overseas. The C.H. Mason Seminary is part of Atlanta's International Theological Center. COGIC musicians of note include Walter and Edwin Hawkins, O Happy Day, Andre Crouch and his twin sister Sandra, My Tribute, To God Be the Glory, and the Winans family, including BB and CeCe. How fitting that in Los Angeles today, where Charles Mason came with a searching heart long ago, the largest congregation in the city is West Angeles Church of God in Christ, with some 25,000 members. Its senior pastor, Charles E. Blake, was elected COGIC presiding bishop in 2007. The effects of one man, ignited by the Holy Spirit, continue to ripple outward for the blessing not only of African American believers, but the entire body of Christ. 4. William J. Seymour, 1870 to 1922, Ignition on Azusa Street. Day after day, he sat alone in the hallway of a small Bible school in Houston, leaning forward to hear as much of the classroom lecture as he could. This son of former slaves would gladly have taken a seat inside with the white students, but the Jim Crow laws of that era would not allow it. What most filled the mind of William Seymour, this single, short, stocky, 35-year-old evangelist, was not the racial bias, but instead what he was learning about the baptism in the Holy Spirit. He was certainly familiar with the concept, it being widely proclaimed throughout the 19th century by holiness and deeper life preachers, even the notable Charles G. Finney, Dwight L. Moody, and A.J. Gordon. But here, the instructor was attaching something outward and audible to the experience, speaking in tongues. Seymour listened to the teacher's various scriptures and came to nod his head in agreement. Not long after, a fellow student passed his name along to a small holiness church in Los Angeles in search of a pastor. Seymour made his way west and in February 1906 stood to give his inaugural sermon. He boldly chose as his text Acts chapter 2, verse 4, King James Version, of course. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance, even though he had not yet spoken in tongues himself. The reception was not encouraging. When Seymour returned for the Sunday evening service, he found the building tightly locked. A couple named Edward and Maddie Lee gave him temporary lodging, and those who had accepted his message began to hold prayer meetings in the humble four-room home of Richard and Ruth Asbury at 214 North Bonnie Bray Street. On April 9th, just as Seymour was about to leave for the prayer meeting, Edward Lee asked for prayer in order to receive the baptism he had heard Seymour speak about. Seymour obliged him, and Lee suddenly began to give glory to God in tongues. At the meeting that night, the surprised Seymour told what had happened. A time of earnest prayer broke out. By the end of the evening, seven people were praising God in languages they had never studied. One young woman, a maid who worked at a home across the street, went to the piano and began to play beautifully, having had no music lessons in her life. Her gift proved to be permanent. The news spread rapidly throughout the city, with crowds growing by the hour. The meetings ran around the clock for the next 3 days. Seymour was forced to preach from the front porch, which eventually collapsed under the weight of the people. A new site would have to be found. And that is how the Azusa Street Mission began on April 15th in an abandoned church building on a side street less than a mile north of downtown L.A., next to a lumber yard, a tombstone shop, and some stables. Seating in the ground-level room was no more than rough planks nailed to empty barrels. The upstairs had a prayer room and several sleeping rooms where Seymour and several associates came to reside. The daily meetings began at 10 a.m. and continued throughout the rest of the day and late into the evening. As many as 1,000 people came on a given day, or tried to listen through the windows. Frank Bartleman, a journalist who reported for various Christian publications, wrote, "There was no pride there. The service ran almost continuously. Seeking souls could be found under the power almost any hour, day or night. People came to meet God. In that old building, with its low rafters and bare floor, God took strong men and women to pieces and put them together again for His glory. It was a tremendous overhauling process. Pride, self-assertion, self-importance, and self-esteem could not survive there. No subjects or sermons were announced ahead of time, and no special speakers for such an hour. No one knew what might be coming, what God would do. All was spontaneous, all of the Spirit. We wanted to hear from God through whomever He might speak. We had no respect of persons. When we first reached the meeting, we avoided as much as possible human contact and greeting. We wanted to meet God first. We got our head under some bench in the corner in prayer and met others only in the Spirit. The meetings started themselves, spontaneously, in testimony, praise, and worship. As a result, literally hundreds were saved. Hundreds experienced physical healings. Verbal expressions from the Spirit were welcomed. Among the songs that frequently rang out was, "The Comforter has come, the Comforter has come, the Holy Ghost from heaven, the Father's promise given." On April 18th, the Los Angeles Times ran a scorching front-page story with headlines that read, "Weird Babble of Tongues, New Sect of Fanatics is Breaking Loose, Wild Scene Last Night on Azusa Street, Gurgle of Wordless Talk by a Sister." It said that, "The night is made hideous in the neighborhood by the howlings of the worshipers, who spend hours swaying back and forth in a nerve-wracking attitude of prayer and supplication." Seymour himself was mocked as an old colored exhorter, he was only 35, who hypnotized people with his stony optic, a glass replacement for his right eye, which had failed during an earlier siege of smallpox. On the other hand, a minister named Arthur Osterberg, who had helped lead the cleanup of the building, described Seymour as meek and plain-spoken, and no orator. He spoke the common language of the uneducated class. He might preach for 3/4 of an hour with no more emotion than that there post. He was no arm-waving thunderer by any stretch of the imagination. There was no pulpit, only 2 crates stacked vertically, into which Seymour sometimes tucked his head for long stretches of prayer during the meetings. There was no choir. In fact, no musical instruments. No offerings were collected. Only a small box on the wall carried the sign, "Settle with the Lord." The open flow of worship and exhortation was hard to manage sometimes because not all were pure-hearted in their desire to participate. Seymour had to give stern corrections from time to time. One day he commented, "I need to say something important. We got too many folk coming in here seeking the tongues. When you go down to the shoe store, you don't say to the clerk, 'I want to buy a pair of tongues.' You just buy the shoes, and the tongues come with them. Folks need to just be seeking the Holy Ghost. The tongues part will take care of itself." In addition to the unstructured meetings, visitors were equally surprised, in this highly segregated era, by the multiracial makeup of the Azusa crowd. Whites, blacks, Mexicans, Chinese, and other ethnicities sat, or stood, or knelt, shoulder to shoulder in the meetings. An iconic photo of the leadership team shows 3 blacks and 8 Caucasians. 5 are men, 6 are women. In the oft-quoted line from Frank Bartleman,
"We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.